the title of my talk suggests that this will be a quantum annealer with full connectivity. This is a work that I did with two postdocs at University of Basel, Simon Nigg and Niels Lark. And we submitted this on archive last year, and it's in press in Science Advances. It should appear either this month or next month. So let me start with the motivation of quantum optimizers. So the aim of quantum optimizers is to optimize. Optimization is simply an action of making the best use of resources or make best of a situation. And we would like to optimize most of our tasks. So the goal is to map this optimization problem to a computational problem that can itself be mapped to Ising interactions between quantum bits. Now, once we map the problem that we are interested in solving to qubits, the hope is that quantum mechanics and quantum interactions help us in getting the solution faster than the classical algorithms. The two main problems facing quantum annealing at the moment, first one is the connectivity. So that's a big challenge because the qubits, the way they are realized, they use some physical interaction, and coupling qubits all to all, each qubit coupled to each other qubit, has put some restrictions on it because qubits are physically separated from each other. The second biggest problem facing quantum optimization is decoherence. Decoherence is simply, it degrades the quantum correlations. So if there is any quantum speedup in doing the computation using quantum annealing, this probability of the computation will be degraded if there is decoherence, because the quantum correlations which are giving rise to speedup will get destroyed. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to propose a new architecture which I claim addresses both of these issues. So we get all-to-all coupling, and this all-to-all coupling is achieved simply by imposing flux quantization in a superconducting ring. And also, I'm going to show that these qubits are robust against the most dominant decoherence channel. So both of the challenges, all-to-all connectivity and the decoherence, are not as bad for if we do quantum annealing using the architecture that I'm going to propose. So once again, this is the reference. And with this, I will start with the outline of my talk. So I will present a brief introduction and then talk about quantum annealing optimizers. And then I'll present the two main challenges in some detail. And then I'll present a resolution to these challenges. And then I'll conclude my talk and present some future outlook. So as an introduction, again, optimization is something that we can use in many tasks. One of the examples of optimization problem that I'm going to use in this talk is the number partitioning problem. Now, what this number partition problem boils down to is you ask the question, if I give you a set of numbers, if I give you a set of assets with fixed values, is it possible to share them fairly between two parties? So as an example, if I give you a set 1, 2, 3, the goal is to partition this set into two sets such that the sum of elements in both sets is the same. So in this case, a set being 1, 2, 3, we can partition it into two sets. The first set has 1 and 2, and the second set has 3. Now, this seemingly simple problem, when the number of elements in the set is very large, or when there are instances such that there are multiple partitions that solve the same partitioning, and it can be computationally very hard to solve at least some instances of this problem. It turns out that this problem is actually NP-hard, which means that there are some instances which are computationally very hard, and they don't scale with a polynomial time. So it also turns out that this problem is isomorphic to finding the ground state configuration of a long-range antiferromagnetic model, Ising model. And this is what I'm going to show you next. Let's see how this is done. So let's look at an energy function. It's a function of n discrete variables, S1 to Sn, and the function itself is sum over NISI whole square. These discrete variables, S1 to Sn, are take values plus and minus 1. Ni's are 1 to n capital N numbers, and these are the numbers, these are positive numbers, and these are the numbers in the original set that we want to partition. So we partition these numbers into two sets, and the value of Si's from 1 to capital N, this tells us to which set these numbers belong. So for each Ni, there is a variable Si. If it is plus 1, it belongs to one partition, and if it is minus 1, it belongs to the other partition. Now we can just rewrite this energy function in terms of this. So I just write this I as ij, nij, si times sj. Now, if I rewrite this ni times nj as jij, this is known in physics literature as the anti-ferromagnetic Ising model if jij is greater than 0. So in this way, I can rewrite this energy function into the anti-ferromagnetic Ising model. Now we can convince ourselves that if a fair partition exists, this energy should be 0. So we have capital N numbers. For some of these numbers, some of these numbers will be in one set for which Si will be plus 1. So giving Si plus 1, all those numbers will add up to something. All other numbers will be in the other set with Si minus 1, so they will all add up to something. And if they are both equal, then this must vanish. So finding a fair partition boils down to finding the zero energy configuration of this problem. So we have boiled down this problem to finding the ground state of the anti-ferromagnetic Ising model. In case the numbers are such that a fair partition does not exist, we'll find the ground state of this Ising model, and this ground state spin configuration will give us the least unfair partition. So by ground state configuration, I mean the ground state will know the values of these variables, S1 to Sn, will know which one of those are plus 1, which one are minus 1, and this is the solution. Now let's talk about quantum annealing. So we just discussed that problems like number partitioning problem can be boiled down to finding ground state of the Ising model. So the goal here now is to find how we can find the ground state in a faster way, as fast as possible. Now, one way to do this is simulated annealing. The idea here is use annealing. So we start at a finite temperature and we cool the system down, and at T equal to 0, at 0 temperature, the system would be in its ground state. So if we cool the system down, then the system would go to its ground state. So the idea here is to simulate annealing using an algorithm. And the way it is done is, let's consider this energy configuration landscape. So what I'm plotting here on the horizontal axis is configuration. So each point here corresponds to some orientation of spins or some values of Si to from 1 to capital N. These configurations correspond to some energy value, and this is just a graph of this. So the way it is simulated is, imagine in this way of doing annealing, it is possible to get trapped in one of the minimas. The way we simulate it is, if we are, say, at a given temperature in this minimum, and that means we are at a finite temperature, and the only way to go from this minimum to the next minimum, which is lower in energy, is to go uphill. And the system can climb over this hill provided that the thermal energy is of the same order as the barrier height. So if the barrier heights are very large, so for very high barriers, we can get trapped in one of the minimas. So we are not able to make a transition to a lower minima. And as a result, when we keep cooling it down and down, at T equals 0, we will not be at the ground state, but we'll be trapped in this state, which is not the right solution. So this is simulated annealing. Another way to solve this problem is to use quantum annealing, which uses quantum tunneling. where we look at the same problem now. Now in quantum annealing, the way we can go from one minima to other minima is using quantum tunneling. So each of these spin configurations now corresponds to a wave function describing the state of the system. Now these wave functions have finite spread. Under this energy landscape is the classically forbidden region. So the wave functions would be exponentially damped in this region. So imagine wave function of this state, it's exponentially damped in this region. The wave function for this state, this is also exponentially damped. But if the barrier is very thin, there will be a finite overlap of wave functions. And this finite overlap of wave functions gives rise to a finite tunneling amplitude between these two states. So this is the idea behind quantum annealing. And this way of doing annealing, we can also get trapped in a minima. This can happen. Imagine if we made it to this minima, but if the other minima is very far away. Now here we again try to find the overlap. Because the barrier is very wide, the overlap between the wave functions would be exponentially small. So if we make it to this barrier, but the next barrier is very wide, we would not be able to go to the lowest minima, and we can also be trapped. It turns out that, okay, so the quantum tunneling, it goes as exponential of the width of the barrier. And it turns out that if you have a problem such that this energy landscape has high but thin barriers, in this situation, quantum annealing beats simulated annealing. And now I'll just present state of art of quantum annealing. So this is a graph I took from this paper, appeared in 2016. What is plotted here is problem size. So on the horizontal axis, we have the number of qubits. On the vertical axis on the left, we have computational time for two algorithms, quantum Monte Carlo method and simulated annealing. And on the right, we have the D-wave annealing time, which uses quantum annealing. So we use three different methods to solve the same optimization problem, and we look at how they scale with system size. So what the key point to see here is that for large system sizes, for example, around 1,000 qubits or so, the difference between the computational time is really large. It's of order 10 to the power 8. So we have 10 to the power 4 here, and we have like 10 to the power 12 for both of these methods. So there is significant time that we can save using quantum annealing over simulated annealing and quantum Monte Carlo methods. So now I will talk about two main challenges that current optimizers face, quantum annealers face. The first one is the connectivity. So what is depicted here is 16 qubits in clusters of two. Within each cluster, we have each qubit connected to all other qubits. So the point here is that each qubit has to talk to all other qubits. And if you want all-to-all connectivity, you need order n square pairwise connections for each of the qubit. The way we usually do annealing is we consider a Hamiltonian, which is something like this. So we have two functions of time. First function of time times a term that for each qubit is just a poly X matrix, so sigma X term. And then we have another function, B of T. And then we have HP, which is the Hamiltonian that describes the problem that we are interested in solving. So now, if we need n square connections, each qubit should have n square connections to all other qubits. This is hard to realize because we will end up using some physical interactions to couple these qubits, like Coulomb interactions or dipole-dipole interactions or some other physical interactions. And most of these interactions actually decay as the distance between them, between the qubits increases. So there is a way around, which is to map a problem that requires all-to-all connectivity to some other problem that does not require all-to-all connectivity, but only requires local connectivity. But there is some overhead that we pay in doing this. So one such method is described here. And the overhead here is if we want n logical qubits, and we start with a problem that has all-to-all connectivity for n logical qubits. To encode this optimization problem using only local interactions, we would need n times n minus 1 by 2 qubits. So for n logical qubits, we need order n square qubits to encode this problem. So there's significant overhead in the trying to avoid all-to-all connectivity. So the challenge here is to ask the question, can all-to-all connectivity be achieved with zero overhead? And this is the goal that we achieve in our architecture. The other main challenge is decoherence. Now, decoherence degrades the quantum correlations in the state, which help the computation. So one way to see this in annealing is if, so at any given time, we look at the eigenbasis, energy eigenbasis of this Hamiltonian, and if decoherence acts only in this instantaneous energy eigenbasis, then this is not a problem for annealing. The reason being that we start with A of t, which is say at t equal to 0, A of t is 1, and B of t is 0. And at some very large time, B of t is 1 and A of t is 0. So we start with a system which is in ground state of sigma x's, and then we do adiabatically, we slowly go to this Hamiltonian where A of t is 0 and B of t is 1, so it's just this Hamiltonian. And if we do it adiabatically, then the ground state, the system always remains in its ground state. And if the decoherence is only acting in the energy eigenbasis, then this cannot hurt. It will remain in its ground state. So annealing in itself is more robust to energy eigenbasis decoherence than other computations. But this is not the full story, because decoherence channels, they depend upon the physical hardware. Depending on what type of qubit you use, there will be different decoherence channels. So it's not clear that the given a setup, that decoherence will only be in the instantaneous energy eigenbasis. And plus, another thing to note here is if you look at other kinds of errors, like dephasing errors, which will be a random action of sigma z, then if you look at this term, it commutes with sigma z's here, but it does not commute with sigma x. So in the beginning of the annealing process, this such a random action will take you out of the ground state. And if it takes you out of the ground state and then you do adiabatically, you go to the Hamiltonian of the problem you're interested in, you will not end up in the ground state of the problem, but you will end up in some excited state. So annealing can fail if you have dephasing errors, because early on in your system, it takes you out of the low energy landscape. So now the challenge here would be, is there a more robust encoding of Ising spins? So let's go ahead and resolve these two challenges. So the architecture that I propose is, we call it continuous variable Ising machine. So this is just a schematic depicting this system. It consists of superconducting, so many Josephson junctions. So each red cross is a Josephson junction. This denotes n, these n green boxes will denote n qubits. We'll connect the first one and the last one using another Josephson junction. So I'll describe this in detail now. So let's ask the question, in this system, where or how is the Ising spin encoded? So to explain how the Ising spin is encoded, I have to discuss what is called a Kerr parametric oscillator. So what a Kerr parametric oscillator is I'll start by describing physically, it's a quantum oscillator with parametric driving. So, and it's not a simple harmonic oscillator, but we include n harmonic terms in the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian that describes this Kerr parametric oscillator, I'll just write down the equation, it's given by this. The first term just describes the well-known simple harmonic oscillator, which is if we just consider a spring mass system and restrict ourselves with the quadratic part of the potential. The second term is the n-harmonic term. This comes from the higher powers of the potential. And the last term is the drive. So this system by itself, without any drive, we are not exciting the system, but we in this particular case, we drive the system in a special way. So the key point here is that the drive term has a dagger square and a square. So we add what a and a daggers are these annihilation and creation operators. So the operator a, annihilation operator, if it acts on a state with n excitations, it gives us a state with n minus one excitations. And a dagger, when it acts on the state with n excitations, we get the n plus one state. So what this drive term does is it adds excitations in numbers of two, and it removes excitations from in pairs also. So this is also known as two photon drive in the system, in the quantum optics language. Another way to look at it is to, again, go back to the spring mass system. So say you have a point mass connected to a spring, and we drive it with some external force F. So classically, if we try to write down the Hamiltonian function, we'll write the kinetic energy, potential energy, and the drive term. So in this case, the kinetic energy is simply P squared over 2m. The potential energy has a harmonic part, which is half m omega squared x squared. This characterizes the spring constant. Just these two terms in the quantum limit give us this term. If we include the higher power of the potential energy in the spring, the x4 term, we get this term in the quantum limit. And this drive term, if we drive this in with this cosine omega t, then we get this term in the quantum limit. Now let's try to look at this Hamiltonian in a bit more detail. Let's start with two simple limits. First, let's consider the limit. So we see here that the Hamiltonian depends on time. So we have the drive term, which is a function of time. So what we would like to do is to go to a frame. So this is written in the lab frame. So we go to a frame which is rotating with half of this frequency. So we choose this as half of this frequency because the drive has a square and a dagger square terms. So then by doing this unitary transformation, we go to a frame which is rotating, but in this frame, the Hamiltonian is time independent. So this, in the rotating frame, the Hamiltonian looks like this. This is the zero point energy, which I just put in the end. This is irrelevant for the dynamics. And this parameter delta now is the difference between the original frequency of the oscillator and the half of the drive frequency. Let's simplify it further. Let's consider a case when this is zero, so there is no detuning. In this case, the Hamiltonian just looks like this. And now let's look at the regime when the drive strength is zero. In the regime when drive strength is zero, the only term in the Hamiltonian is this square term and the zero point energy. And now we can convince ourselves that vacuum is the ground state of this system. So what that means is if you start in vacuum, or if we consider the vacuum state, this annihilation operator will act on vacuum and will give us zero. So we have found the ground state, it's simply vacuum. Now let's try to look at the same Hamiltonian in the other regime, which is very large drive strength. And this is how we will do annealing. We will start with zero drive in the vacuum and will adiabatically increase the drive strength. So in the limit of large drive, I again look at the Hamiltonian with zero detuning for a moment. It turns out that this Hamiltonian can be conveniently rewritten in this form. So if I multiply these terms, I get this term, a dagger square times this term is simply going to give me this first term. This combination gives me this term. There's a constant part that I've subtracted, and this is the zero point energy. Why I have written it like this is because I know how to find eigenstates of this operator. This is simply the annihilation operator, and I know eigenstates of annihilation operators. They're simply coherent states. So for large driving strengths, we can basically guess the eigenstates of the system, which are coherent states. In fact, there are two coherent states because we have a square. Both coherent states plus n minus alpha are degenerate eigenstates of this Hamiltonian. What I mean is, so A, operator A acting on this state, coherent state alpha, gives us alpha times the same state. So the eigenvalue of the coherent state plus minus alpha is plus minus alpha. So when A square acts on the same state, you will get alpha square, and alpha is the square root of drive over K. So when I put this here, this term vanishes. So both of them have eigen energy minus square of drive divided by the Kerr term. So we have in large drive strength, we have a system that has two degenerate eigenstates, and this is the way we encode Ising-spin. So this plus and minus alpha, these are two states. One is the coherent state alpha, and the other is coherent state alpha times e to the power I pi. So the way we encode Ising-spin is in this phase. So the Ising-spin plus one or minus one corresponds to the phase of the Kerr parametric oscillator. So this will correspond to plus one, this will correspond to minus one. So imagine now that we increase the drive strength from zero to this large value of drive strength where we have these well separated coherent states, plus and minus alpha as the eigenstates. One way to look at it is following. So we look at the potential landscape. This actually can be easily understood from this classical Hamiltonian function. So I'll just go back and do this here. So imagine if your drive is zero. So this term is absent, then your potential is just x squared plus x to the power four. This potential has only one minima. Now imagine increasing the drive strength. There will come a point when this term will be larger than this term. When drive strength is large, then you end up with x4 minus x squared potential. And this is the double well potential which has two minimas now. So this is what we are actually doing in the annealing. We are starting in the vacuum state. We start with zero drive. Then the system is in minima corresponding to this. And then we increase the drive strength. And as the drive strength increases, the Kerr parametric oscillator undergoes bifurcation. And instead from this minima, we end up in this double well minima where we have two degenerate coherent states as eigenstates, which correspond to plus one and minus one. So they are depicted here. So this is how the Ising-spin is encoded. But now we are interested not just in one qubit, but many qubits, and they are also coupled to each other. So for one qubit, what we discussed earlier is that the drive term has to be larger than the quadratic part of the Hamiltonian. This can be simply calculated from here. This is the quadratic part, the harmonic part of the Hamiltonian. So when the drive strength is larger than the detuning delta, that is the bifurcation threshold. When the drive is smaller than this detuning, then there is only one minima, and the system is in vacuum state. When drive strength is larger than this bifurcation threshold, then we have a double well minima, and we can define the Ising-spin as 0 and 1 as two different coherent states. Now consider n coupled Kerr parametric oscillators. So now we have n such oscillators, and all of these oscillators are coupled to each other. And where the coupling term looks like this, so we have sum over n and m from 1 to capital N, where the coupling interaction is such that we destroy an excitation in the mth Kerr parametric oscillator and create an excitation in the nth Kerr parametric oscillator. And now imagine that we adiabatically increase the two photon drive on each of the Kerr parametric oscillators. So we slowly adiabatically increase drive on each of these n oscillators. So what will end up happening is all of these Kerr parametric oscillators will undergo bifurcation. So if at very small driving strengths, the state of the system can be written like this. So it's vacuum for all n oscillators. And if we increase the drive adiabatically, this state, the vacuum state, is adiabatically connected to this state. Now this state is a superposition state. It's a superposition of two kets. Let's look at the first ket. The first ket is this coherent state alpha, which is the square root of drive strength divided by the Kerr term. The magnitude of the strength of the coherent state depends on the drive strength. And it has these prefactors S1. So all each n oscillator has these prefactors S1 to Sn. The other ket in the superposition is the same thing, but with all minus signs. All these S variables, they are plus 1 or minus 1. They are such that the icing energy JNM Sn Sm is minimized. So what happens is we adiabatically ramp up the drive of all of these oscillators, and we map, if we start in vacuum, we go to this state. Now, why this state is useful is to think of the action of annihilation operator in one of these states. So this is a superposition state, but if there is, say, decoherence, we will end up in either, the system will collapse to either this one or this one. So imagine, say, the second oscillator, there is annihilation operator that acts on it. So if in the second oscillator, you have annihilation operator, coherent states are eigenstates, so you'll pull out a factor of S2 here. Here you'll pull out a factor of minus S2. So you see that you can take S2 outside. This sign is sensitive to decoherence. So quantum correlations will indeed be destroyed, and the system will collapse to either this ket or this ket. But this is not a problem for us, because both of these kets encode the right solution. What we care about to solve the number partitioning problem is the relative signs. So we have plus 1 denoting that it's in one set, minus 1 denoting that it is in the other set. So no matter which of these kets the system ends up in, we have the right solution. So this provides a robust method, a robust scheme to encode the optimization problem. So how does it work? We can build some intuition into this by simply consider the simplest case. Let's consider two coupled Kerr parametric oscillators. So this is the Hamiltonian describing the one oscillator. And now for two oscillators, I will have two such Hamiltonians, and I will have the coupling term. Now I call the modes in the other oscillator B. The coupling term is simply A dagger B plus B dagger A. So I destroy an excitation in one and create in the other oscillator and the Hermite conjugate of this. To understand how this bifurcation happens only in the right solution or in the ground state of the antiferromagnetic Ising model, it's convenient to go to a different basis. So we define a new basis, D and C modes, where D is a symmetric combination of the two oscillators, and C is the antisymmetric combination of the two oscillators. In terms of this mode, we can rewrite the Hamiltonian, and the Hamiltonian looks like this. The key point here is that now these two different modes, D and C, have different thresholds, have different detunings. For the D mode, which is the symmetric combination, A plus B, this term, instead of, so we'll have D dagger D term for the D mode, this will have a constant delta plus J, and the C mode will have delta minus J. So what that means is, also last two terms, they are far, we can ignore their effect on dynamics because they are rotating with frequency much higher than the rest of the terms. So the key point here is that the D and C modes have different bifurcation threshold. The bifurcation threshold for them is now absolute value of delta plus and minus J. To be concrete, let's start with some large negative delta and consider the case when J is greater than 0. When J is greater than 0 and delta is large and negative, we'll say that delta plus J mode will have a lower bifurcation threshold than the C mode. Similarly, if J is less than 0, the C mode bifurcates before D mode. And if you look at the relative sign, D mode is when both the coherent states alpha and beta are in phase, and this corresponds to the ferromagnetic solution. C mode has the opposite phase of the coherent states. So if J is greater than 0, we have a ferromagnetic Ising model where the ground state will be the both spins in the same direction. And the way it will happen is we'll do the annealing, the system will start in vacuum, and it is this mode that will undergo bifurcation first. So this mode will get populated while the other mode is still in its vacuum state. So what is really happening when we have n coupled oscillators is that we start in the vacuum state, and if we ramp up the drive adiabatically, it's the first state that undergoes bifurcation is the solution, happens to be the solution of the antiferromagnetic Ising model, provided we choose detunings such that it's large and negative, so just like in this case. So the solution of the antiferromagnetic Ising model undergoes bifurcation first, and that's why it gets populated and all other modes are still in their vacuum state. So now, how to realize this system using physically implemented, using resources that we have? So the system we consider is superconducting qubits. So we consider Josephson junctions for to implement these this way of doing quantum annealing. So what I show here is these are n qubits, these green boxes. So now we look at one qubit per se. So let's take a look at this one green box. What this one green box is, it includes two Josephson junctions. Now, what a Josephson junction is, it's basically two superconductors separated by a weak link. If there is a voltage across the superconductor, this voltage is across the two superconductors is proportional to the rate of change of the phase difference between the two superconductors. And the proportionality constant is simply h over 2e is the Planck constant. So if you are interested in writing the total electrical energy in this split ring system, in this system, we'll have to write the capacitive energy of these two junctions and the potential energy. The capacitive energy is simply half CV square. So the voltage across first one is phi 1 dot square, second one phi 2 dot square, and the potential energy, the phase difference between the superconductors is phi 1 and phi 2. So we have this potential term. Now we'll just do some algebra, which we don't have to do it in detail here. You'll have to take my word. So it's relatively straightforward. We define new variables. We have one constraint along this loop, which is gauge invariance. So the system must be gauge invariant. And using this constraint, we get a relation between the phase difference between across the two junctions and the flux that is threaded through the ring. Using this constraints, we can define new variables. And if we rewrite the Lagrangian in terms of these new variables, we get such a term. The key point here is to see this is cosine phi 1 plus cosine phi 2. So this can be simply written as cosine phi 1 plus phi 2 by 2. And using gauge invariance, we can have cosine phi by 2 and phi 1 minus phi 2, which we have defined as new variable theta. The key point here is now we have prefactor of this cosine term has cosine capital phi by 2. This provides us a way of tuning this part of the Hamiltonian. So if you make this flux time dependent by applying an AC modulation, we can actually tune the Josephson energy of this junction. So now we do the usual we do in classical mechanics. From the Lagrangian, we go to the Hamiltonian. So we have generalized coordinate as theta. We define generalized momentum, write down the Hamiltonian of the system. And now we use some tricks. So the Hamiltonian will again have this cosine of phi term. This phi is the external flux through the loop. This external flux, we can have a constant time independent part and a time dependent part. The time dependent part itself, we choose as sine omega t plus phi. So we can see here we have cosine of phi by 2, where phi by 2 is this. So if cosine of a plus b, which will be written as cosine a cosine b minus sine a sine b. So what we really have is cosine of this term, which is cosine of sine and sine of sine. Now cosine of sine and sine of sine can be expanded in terms of Bessel functions. So we'll go ahead and do this expansion, and we'll furthermore assume that the strength of this is very small compared to the DC part. In this limit, we can restrict ourselves to the lowest order terms, which is the zeroth Bessel function, which is constant, and the first one. With these approximations, we write down our Hamiltonian as it has a time-independent part and a time-dependent part. The time-independent part has the usual cosine theta term, and a time-dependent part, which has the sine omega t plus phi. Now we expand this cosine theta around its minimum value. When we do that expansion, we'll have a quadratic term, a fourth power term. This is similar to the x square and x4 terms that we had. And we also needed a drive term, which comes from this part. So we have a theta square term. There will also be a theta 4 term here, but notice that it has this Bessel function. So it makes the theta 4 term coming from this term is one order lower in strength, so we can discard that. So in the end, now we go to we quantize these variables. In the end, the Hamiltonian of the system looks like this, and this is precisely what we wanted. So the time-dependent part, or the flux through the ring, it has an AC part, and that AC part gives us the two-photon drive, which we were after. And we also have the enharmonic part that comes from the cosine potential. So I've shown you that using superconductors, using Josephson junctions, and tuning the flux through it, we can realize Kerr parametric oscillators, which is precisely what we wanted. Now comes the question, how do we couple them? So we couple them by connecting this junction to this junction with another Josephson junction, which is a large area Josephson junction, and it is a special Josephson junction such that the minimum of this, so Josephson energy is cosine of phi. So the minimum that, if I ask the question, what is the minimum of minus cosine phi, the answer would be zero. There are some Josephson junctions where the minimum is not at zero, but at pi. And these are called pi junctions. What is needed here is to have a Josephson junction which acts like a pi junction. And if we do that, we write the potential energy of the whole system and try to find the lowest energy configuration. And what we find is that in its lowest energy, we get a cosine of sum over all phi n's, which when we expand has the diagonal part and has the off-diagonal part, which is precisely the all-to-all coupling that we need. So we can indeed get coupling of one of these oscillators with all other oscillators by demanding this Josephson junction to be a pi junction. So there are some ways of doing it. We can either use a superconductor, ferromagnet superconductor to realize a pi junction, or we can thread a flux of pi through this blue loop, which is more straightforward than putting a ferromagnet in the junction. So there are a few ways around this. So this would provide us a way to realize all-to-all anti-ferromagnetic coupling. Now it comes with zero overhead. Now let's talk about how the second problem is resolved in the system, which is the robustness to decoherence. Now the dominant source of decoherence is energy dissipation in the system, how it comes. So to read out the phase of the coherent state, we'll couple it to some transmission line. And by opening the system to measurement, we will introduce sources of error. And this source of photon loss, or this source can be thought of as annihilation, this source of noise can be thought of as annihilation operator action, or it destroys energy. It destroys an excitation in the system. Now, in our annealing system, I showed that in the limit of small driving, the state of the system is the vacuum state. In the limit of large driving, the state of system was the superposition state of two kets. In the limit of low driving, there are no excitations to destroy. So the system is quite robust to energy losses. In the limit of very large driving, coherent states are the eigenstates. So again, the system is robust because this sign will get destroyed. So the correlation between the superposition state will get destroyed as a result of decoherence, but because both of the kets encode the right solution, our way of doing annealing is robust to this photon loss. We can also calculate its robustness to another source, which is photon dephasing, so the way we define our qubit is in alpha and minus alpha. So we calculate what will be the probability of making a transition from alpha to minus alpha. So this will be a dephasing event. When we calculated, this goes as exponential with the alpha square. So if we choose parameters, which is drive strength and the care parameter, such that this exponential, this alpha is quite large, we can make the system very robust to even photon dephasing events. So not only energy loss, but hopefully even to photon dephasing, this architecture is quite robust. So now in the last 5 minutes or so, let me show a simulation where we simulate a simple, one instance of the number partitioning problem. So we use this set, 4, 5, 6, 7. And the goal is to find the partition of this set. So we know the correct partitions are 4 and 7 in one set and 5 and 6 in the other set. So we do a numerical simulation. So we consider 4 oscillators, and these are the results. So we consider 4 oscillators. We ramp up the drive. So 4 oscillators, they are all connected to each other. The coupling between them is simply given by the product of the numbers that we saw in the beginning. So the, for number partitioning problem, the coupling strength between, say, first and the second oscillator is just product of these two. So it's just 20. Say first and the last one is 7 times 4. These two, 6 times 5. So we know all these numbers are fixed. So the coupling is fixed as soon as we fix the numbers. So we use these coupling strengths. And on the horizontal, so let's look at this plot A here. So the A here shows the results we obtained for continuous variable Ising machine. On the horizontal axis is plotted the ramp rate. So it's the rate at which, inverse of the rate at which we increase the drive. On the vertical axis here is plotted the kappa, the energy, the decoherence rate, so energy loss rate, kappa. So the system has a finite, system loses photons at a finite rate. If we have an ideal system such that there is no photon loss, there is, it's a closed, or imagine a closed system, then kappa is 0. So we'll be on this axis. Now we discussed that we have to do annealing adiabatically. We have to ramp up the drive adiabatically. What that means is if we ramp the drive very fast, this annealing might not work. And this is seen here. If we ramp it very fast, then the inverse of it will be 0. So we see that the system fails. So red is success probability 0, and blue is success probability 1. The way we measure success probability is we let the system evolve, and we start at some small time, and at very large time, look at the phases of the coherent states in all of these oscillators. And from these phases, we deduce what are the partitions that we are getting. And if the partitions are indeed correct, then the success probability is 1. And then we do many simulations and take an average over these simulations. So we see that the success probability is actually 0 if we ramp up the drive very fast. So this is the adiabatic threshold. So we cannot ramp up the drive very fast. We have to do it slow enough. And then if we do it slow enough, we have ideal system, we'll get a probability of 1 on this line. But now let's consider the case of finite kappa. When the system has finite decay rate, we still have to do it slow enough. So there is some adiabatic threshold, but we cannot be too slow. If we are too slow, such that the system starts losing photons, then there will come a point when the success probability starts degrading, is no longer 1. Now, these plots are details of numerics. They correspond to measuring how many loss events are there. So on this plot, this white line signifies events when there is 1 photon loss, but there can be multiple also. Let's not worry about multiple losses here. So the main message here is that we have to do adiabatic, we have to do it slow enough, but we cannot be too slow. We should still try to be faster than the decay rate. Let's compare with similar parameters the case when we do quantum annealing using discrete systems, like spin systems. This is a simulation shown here. Now here again, if we look at a perfect system, we see there is some adiabatic threshold, but after that, we get success probability of 1. But now the key point to note is that as soon as you have any decoherence in the system or any random sigma z term, the success probability quickly goes to zero. So most of this parameter regime, we have success probability close to zero. While here you see you have even like the machine is successful 50% of times, even when there is more than one photon loss. And this is precisely because if there is a random action of sigma z in the early part of the annealing, the system is excited to a high energy regime. And then if you keep on doing annealing or adiabatically increasing the parameters, you will not end up in the ground state of the system you want. So the main message here is that optimization using continuous variable Ising machines is more robust. We get success probabilities of 0.5 even when the average number of photons lost is more than one. And optimization with spin-based or the discrete qubit systems fails already after a single dephasing event, sigma z. So with this, let me conclude my talk and present some future outlook. So I've proposed a quantum Ising optimization machine with superconducting circuits, which might solve two of the biggest problems in this field of quantum optimization. The flux quantization, and especially having a pi junction as a shunt that gives us all-to-all connectivity without any overhead. The using this continuous variable encoding for minimization, the annealing succeeds with a higher probability even in the presence of photon loss events. So outlook now, this is, I must mention, this is just the beginning of this field. There are very few papers in this field at the moment. This is one of the first ones to propose using this pi junction and so on. So there are many open questions. One of the questions is, of course, like I just discussed here, number partitioning problem. The question would be, can we go beyond the number partitioning problem? Now, number partitioning problem requires all-to-all connectivity, but it requires limited tunability. The coupling between the spins is fixed by the numbers, so you don't have independent tuning between them. So it's a bit easier to implement. So by that I mean is Jij, sigma j term, the two qubits being I and j, the Jij is just fixed. So if you consider the most general optimization problem in term which can be encoded in an Ising spin, you have order n square coupling Jijs. But here we just have n parameters to tune with, which are the fluxes through these n care parametric oscillators. So one way to move forward is to work on whether we can use similar architecture for going beyond the number partitioning problem. Next would be to show conclusively that there is some quantum speedup in these systems. And also what we want to look at is to how the system behaves if you increase the number of qubits, how does the computational time scale? And then this is, just to wrap up, this is just the beginning of this story. I hope, stay tuned. I hope I answer some of these questions in my future talks at IGC and the answers are more positive. And last, I will put in some other references that I used in this talk. Thank you very much for your attention.